ambulance services the patient breathing?
It seems like he's all losing consciousness.
He's weaning blood, really red blood.
I've had it once before and I've had a heart attack.
This could be anything.
This is a 12-hour shift with West Midlands Ambulance Service.
Being a paramedic is definitely not a job for the faint-hearted.
Did you remember what happened?
I think you had a seizure.
Every 20 seconds, they receive a call for help.
It's agony, it's absolute agony. There's blood underneath him.
From the 5.6 million people who live here.
Probably the worst day of their life for someone to call an ambulance.
I would say you dislocated your femur.
Filming simultaneously with 8 paramedic crews.
Is there where he's been stabbed?
Potentially in the thigh.
This is what happened when you last had your heart attack.
This is life on the front line.
You're training for the day when you're the person between the patient and their grave.
You ready?
Party on.
Yeah, let's go.
Rock and roll.
Sean Hopkins and Paul Brown booking on for a 6:30, 6:30. Good morning.
You're hoping it's a good one.
Which is lovely and sunny, so nice day.
It's good weather for driving, and in any 12-hour shift, the paramedics of West Midlands Ambulance Service can cover hundreds of miles. But their thoughts this early in the morning are often light years away.
Do you think we're alone in this universe of ours?
I don't like the idea of aliens. And I've watched too many alien films to know it doesn't end well.
Apparently NASA or someone like that have been sending naked images of humans into space.
I suppose that's enough to keep the aliens away, isn't it?
Imagine like walking in and you see like an alien with like 7 heads and you're like, hello, it's like a normal human being. And
like, Men in Black type job, eh? Like a Bolchinian.
Never watched it, I don't know what you're on about.
Oh my god! How can you not have seen Men in Black?
We talk about really boring stuff in the cab most of the time, don't we?
What's for dinner?
Yeah, have we fed the cats?
Which is left in the lunch bag.
You.
Oh, that's me, yeah.
Mark and Sarah have been a couple for 9 years and have worked together as crewmates for 7 of them.
Might have that chocolate bar, actually. I'm going to get them out for us.
Now I think, oh, I'll have a sweet. No, I won't.
Mean.
But true.
So, next job, it's a 46-year-old female. Fell over the other day, knocked herself out and cut her ear.
When we receive a call that the patient has fallen a couple of days ago, it's always a concern to us as to what's going on inside the body. Our initial thoughts were that the patient could be having some serious internal problems going on. Yeah.
Hello.
Hello.
I'll have you, it's all.
What do we call you?
Lindsay.
Hello. I'm Mark, this is Sarah.
46-year-old Lindsay fell over 2 days ago, cutting her ear. Partner Carl is with her.
Lindsay looked very, very poorly on arrival, and my heart went out to her.
Let me just have a quick look around the side here. You've got, it's all matted. Got your hair stuck on your ear, your ears. Blimey. Your ears ripped.
The fact that Lindsay had left it a few days was going to make her treatment harder. A torn ear, she'd have to have all the skin snipped for it to be reattached.
Well, it's dangerous.
Infection.
Yeah.
All of it, the whole thing was just really worrying, really.
This was getting the remote control back from underneath the table.
Okay. What's that from? And that?
That one just appeared.
Right, OK. Now, this side. You've got both knees... Oh.
Lindsay has liver disease. This causes scarring, which stops the liver working properly.
I wouldn't be surprised if it's something to do with the liver disease as well.
I know I've got low platelets and too many white cells.
When a patient has low blood platelets, this can indeed cause extreme bruising with a slight knock. So that made more sense as to why she was so bruised from head to foot.
Is your jaundice colour normal for you, is it?
No, it's got worse in the past couple of days.
A damaged liver is unable to remove waste products from the bloodstream effectively. Over time, chemicals build up that lead to jaundice.
Let's just check your temperature on this side.
Probably the worst bruising I've ever seen.
Absolutely.
On one person.
Yes. So, catastrophic.
Yeah, yeah, very poorly lady.
We talk about food a lot. Like, we fixate on food quite a lot. Like, we talk about when we're going to eat.
Did you have breakfast, Mum?
I have not had my breakfast yet this morning. You're a sandwich master, and I like bringing a scabby little sandwich, and I can see you looking down your nose at me with your massive bloomer and your scones.
Yes, I do like a scone.
I'm much more concerned with doing my hair than eating food.
Yeah, I can feel that. You know, I have the same... They're my eyebrows, you know. Windy today.
Ambulance service, is the patient breathing?
Yes. He's got pains in his chest. He's gone very pale. He's previously had a heart attack and he's on medication for that. It seems like he's all losing consciousness, to be honest.
Patient's breathing appears to be very laboured.
Thank you. We'll give you an update when we get there.
Thank you so much.
OK, Paul, so this job is 74-year-old male, has had chest pain today. He seems confused and has had a previous heart attack, but he's deteriorated while he's on the call and his breathing is quite laboured. So sounds quite serious.
When it comes through that a patient has had a previous heart attack, you know, it can make you slightly more apprehensive because it could be happening again.
She's crying, so we need to hurry up.
Essentially, they need to be taken to the hospital for further treatment as quickly as possible.
Hello.
Thank you.
Hello.
Great to see you. Okay.
Hello, sir. What's happened to you? What's this gentleman's name?
Graham.
Hello, Graham. I'm Sean.
Hello.
Are you not feeling very good?
74-year-old Graham is complaining of chest pain. His wife, Gail, and daughter, Keely, are with him.
I just went around my daughter's next door, come back, and this is how we was. It happened in seconds.
All right, my love, let's get you checked over.
So he's had a previous heart attack?
Yeah, he had a stent fitted.
Graham's very sweaty, very clammy, very pale, disorientated, and also he felt what they call an impending sense of doom, which is classic for people that are experiencing a cardiac problem, such as a heart attack. His blood pressure's quite low.
Is it? What are we talking?
99.
What time did Graham take the GTN at?
What's
a
GTN?
The spray,
the red spray?
As Graham had a heart attack 8 years ago, he was prescribed a spray called GTN. This works by widening the blood vessels.
Graham, did you feel worse after the spray?
Okay.
Yeah. Have you still got that pain?
Yeah.
All right, darling.
Concerned that Graham may be having another heart attack, Sean carries out an ECG.
Do you feel the same as last time you had a heart attack?
Exactly
the same?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm sorry to be such a nuisance.
You are not a nuisance. If it is, elevation is tiny.
In Graham's case, his ECG looked normal. However, in all cases of chest pain, it is best to have a blood test to rule out anything cardiac in nature.
Has he had any breakfast?
No.
Oh, right.
He has to be out too early in the morning. He used to be when he went away. But...
I think that what's happened is the GTN has dropped his blood pressure.
A common side effect of taking the GTN spray is that your blood pressure drops. And Graham was showing classic signs of this with his clamminess and feeling a bit disorientated. Have you ever used it before?
Yeah, but he has used it. And obviously, with him getting as he did, we just thought that was the best thing for him to take.
No, you're right, you're absolutely right. It's prescribed for him to take it in this circumstance.
Although Sian suspects the GTN may be responsible for Graham's symptoms, she can't rule out a second heart attack.
So what we'll do is we'll get his blood pressure back up.
Yeah.
We can't see anything acute on here, so...
But with cardiac conditions, especially chest pain, you can sometimes doesn't show anything on your ECG, but he will need to go to hospital.
Yeah.
I'll do some obs on you, and then we'll get you parcelled up and off to hospital.
In Cannock, paramedics Mark and Sarah are with 46-year-old Lindsay, who has liver disease. She's fallen and is badly bruised.
Right, let me just check your blood sugar, Lindsay. Sharp scratch on your finger. Are you diabetic?
No.
Oh, my word. I've got a BM of 17 and ketones. So, something's going on somewhere.
Before eating, a normal blood sugar reading is between 4 and 6. At 17, Lindsay risks organ damage if she doesn't get treated in hospital.
You're a bit poorly, love. With the level of bruising that you've got and the blood pressure that you've got...
And the oozing head wound you've got.
Yeah, we've got a concern that you might have some internal bleeding somewhere. So what we're going to do is pop a needle into your arm and give you some fluid because your blood pressure is really quite low.
She got so much going on for her age.
Yeah, underlying conditions and...
Awful.
She was potentially very seriously ill, wasn't she?
Yes, she was.
Stop squeezing my hand, that's my girlfriend. Sharp scratch. If you don't like needles, close your eyes like I do. It's an old one, but it makes me smile every time.
Before leaving for hospital, Mark wants to see whether the intravenous fluids have had any effect.
I'll just check your blood pressure before we zip off.
Okay. 74 over 41. You're not helping us. It's about half what it should be.
With her levels still dangerously low, Lindsay needs critical care treatment.
We'll take you up to Stoke because that's a trauma hospital that has every consultant on hand that you might need. Lindsay's case was probably one of the most serious ones I've attended in my career.
Have you got her back?
Yeah. It's just behind her head.
Right.
There wasn't a great deal that we could do for Lindsay. It was a case of treating her at hospital. We did what we could and got her to the right place.
Lindsay arrives at Royal Stoke University Hospital. Here, doctors will determine whether her extensive bruising is a symptom of internal bleeding. She may also need an emergency blood transfusion.
I've not seen bruising like that for a long time.
No. And that was one of those cases where it's not what we can see that we're concerned about.
It's what's inside we can't see.
It's what we can't see.
Poorly lady for her
age. She is.
Mum's really cold.
10 miles north of Stoke, paramedics Sian and Paul are with 74-year-old Graham. His blood pressure dropped after taking medication to treat the symptoms of a heart attack.
So, I'm a bit confused now.
OK, go on.
Did we do wrong?
Not at all.
Doing that?
problem is, I said, if he's not been eating and drinking much at all, and then his blood pressure's been sort of going on the low side for a period of time, I said, as soon as you give him that to relieve the pain, it could drop it. Yeah. He'll drop it a little bit and take the edge off it, so he is going to go pale.
Yeah. So really, what he should be doing is having something eaten in the morning. Can you tell him? Because no good me telling him.
What, feeding him up, though?
Yeah.
Who's staying here?
Yeah. No, he's not staying here.
He's not staying here,
no. He is bossy, isn't he? Can't have your potato, that's for sure.
I think it was terrifying for his family more so, wasn't it?
I think they were all concerned because of his history.
Graham had a heart attack 8 years ago and is at an increased risk of having another. To rule this out, he needs to go to hospital.
Right then, let's get you out of here. I think that if that had been one of my family members, I think I would have been concerned as well.
He's got the impending doom and he feels like he's going to die.
I feel like at least he's dying.
You haven't. Can't be too careful, can you? Not with chest pain, we don't mess around.
Sian needs to constantly monitor Graham's heart during the journey to hospital.
Nice and still for me, Graham. Just take another snapshot of your heart again, OK?
You can't. You can never get complacent.
Never. You've got to keep an eye on patients all the time. Right then, let's go on our trip to the hospital. What a day out.
Thought I was having a heart attack.
Yeah.
It's the same sensation.
Yeah.
My arms were way heavy.
Yeah.
But I didn't remember the pain being so intense.
Okay, so this time it was worse. Okay.
But suddenly, Graham's condition seems to take a turn for the worse.
I don't know what this is, but I can feel the pain coming back again.
It can be upsetting or worrying if a patient starts to deteriorate and you're on your own in the back with them, but you just need to focus on your training and your basics. It's a chewable aspirin. And stick to those every time. That's how you keep calm and just follow what you know you've got to do. But they're disgusting. Sorry. How's that pain out of 10?
It's a 6.
Let's have your arm. Lovely, right. I'll give you a little bit of this morphine, OK?
With his pain under control, Graham arrives at Royal Stoke University Hospital. His wife, Gail, is also here.
So his pain came back a little bit. So he's had some morphine now, so I think it's made him a bit fuzzy.
Doctors will now treat his chest pain and investigate whether he's had a heart attack.
He was definitely something going on.
We couldn't rule out because of his history of cardiac condition.
He really didn't want to be a bother to us. Don't you find that the older generation of people, a lot of them don't call for an ambulance because they think they're bothering people. They think they're putting people out.
Yeah.
But lovely man. Really, really nice guy.
Yeah, welcome to the ambulance service.
He must get on. He's chose me as his best man, so he must be sucker for punishment.
Yeah, I know. I don't know what I've let myself in for yet, do I?
Let's bring on the noise. Didn't work first time. You're not in hot fuzz.
The thing now is we can't fall out with each other because we've got dirty secrets on
dark,
each other, basically.
Dark secrets. I've got your black book.
Yeah, I've got yours.
Hello, ambulance service. Is the patient breathing?
Yes.
What's happened? What's the matter?
Well, it's my partner. He's had a water infection for a week. He had antibiotics off the GP.
Yeah.
He's finished the antibiotics. He's weaned blood. Really red. It was blood.
Bleeding.
He had actually only got one kidney as well.
So, we are off to a 58-year-old male who's had a recent UTI, still got blood in his urine,
only one kidney, and has antibiotics, apparently.
The symptoms that came through on the CAD were a little bit unusual for a male of this age. However, when you read he's only got one kidney, that could explain the symptoms, because when that kidney gets unwell, it could get unwell really quickly.
Stuck in the toilet.
He's in the toilet.
How long has it been like that for?
He's had an infection for a week. He was weaned off 2 days ago.
Oh, right, OK. So we're up and about then.
58-year-old garage owner Mark was in so much pain he had to leave work early.
I've just feel as though I'm all the time.
P for Britain.
Yeah.
Well, that's your water infection, but if there's nothing in there to come out,
okay.
Should we give straight on board
it's
the bath?
It's like yeah. Blobs of
slugs.
Blood.
Yeah.
The fact that Mark was telling me he felt like he needed to constantly pee, when he did go to pee, he was just passing blood, was a bit of a concern to me, because he's got one kidney, and it sounds like this one kidney is actually in a lot of distress at the minute.
With the one kidney, boss, you're not on dialysis, have you? Or...
No, I don't need a kidney.
Okay, so the other one too. Top man.
Let's go have a sit down so we can check you over.
Mark's partner, Sheila, and his two daughters, Amanda and Sophie, are with him.
Pop your finger in there for me.
When I first met Mark, he looked in absolute agony. He really did not look very well at all. He's either got a blockage within the kidney or the bladder, or the kidney's starting to shut down, or something sinister is really going on with his only good kidney.
All right, pop this in your ear. Oh. That's fine, that is. 36.9 on there. Oh. Not diabetic or anything?
No.
How could we gave a kidney away?
My brother. I gave one to my brother and my son gave one to his son.
Fair play to you.
With polycystic kidneys.
Some members of Mark's family have a rare inherited disorder called polycystic kidney disease. This is where cysts grow inside the kidneys, which prevents them working properly.
How is your brother now? Is he all right?
He's 75, so it's lasted 22 years, and he's still going strong.
Still going strong.
Well, for someone to give a kidney to her own flesh and blood is a big step.
Yeah, you're a legend, aren't you? If you can share your organs if somebody's really unwell and give that second chance of life.
We need more people like that in the world. When you woke up this morning and had a pee, was that normal?
Yeah.
Fine.
Mark is at higher risk of having water infections, and he's at higher risk of having severe water infections just for a simple fact, he only has the one kidney.
It's going to be one of two things. It's either you've got really bad bladder infection that's causing it to be like this and it's tracking up to your kidney, or you've got an obstruction.
OK.
Either way, it needs looking at the hospital. Okay. There ain't no way I can fix that here.
OK.
Whatever the cause of Mark's symptoms, he needs to pass water constantly, and it's a painful experience.
He's supposed to be going away tomorrow, so he thinks he's going on holiday.
I wouldn't be going on holiday.
We're going landlord now, until Monday.
Yeah, there's no way that's he's going.
Across the West Midlands, we're following 8 paramedic crews simultaneously as they work a 12-hour day shift.
Right, while you're up and about, shall we get gone?
I'm following in the car.
In Stoke-on-Trent, paramedics Tony and Adam are with 58-year-old Mark, who has one kidney. He's been passing blood and is in severe pain.
All antibiotics might not cut it for Mark, we're having one kidney. So we need to go into hospital to have intravenous antibiotics and maybe a kidney scan.
You have a seat on this one, bud?
Yeah.
Let's get them doors shut and we'll get gone. Are you happy to party, aunt?
Yeah, let's roll.
I thought this had bloody gone away.
Yeah. I bet you wish you had. It isn't a pleasant. And to be honest, your missus said you're supposed to be going away tomorrow.
Yeah.
If it's like this, I wouldn't bother. You need to be at home, bud, because
going away and this happening ain't going to be fun, and especially if you're stuck, where are you going again? Wales?
Yeah, just the extravaganza, Land Unknown.
Oh, yeah, I know Land Unknown.
Show a scooter there, see?
Oh, do you?
Yeah, no, I can't, well, in a motorhome all weekend. There's quite a few hours.
How many daughters you got?
Two daughters in this one.
Which one's the less mither?
To be honest, I've been very lucky.
Oh, have you? Good.
Yeah. I cause distress because I never stop worrying about him.
When Mark was shouting in pain, unfortunately, it's not a pain we can really take away. I don't really want to give him a really strong painkiller to take the pain away and damage the kidney permanently.
Just one big wee and I'm sure it'll be all right.
As the kidneys process toxins in the body, any medication could overwhelm Mark, who donated one of his kidneys to his brother.
Just get your brother on the phone, give him a ring and ask him for that back, you know. Was it much of a hard decision, or...?
For me?
Yeah.
It was either his birthday party or his funeral, wasn't it, so... And in all fairness, if I'd got three kidneys, I'd do it again.
Fair enough.
Mark arrives at Royal Stoke University Hospital.
Then, buddy, nice and steady down this ramp.
Yeah, no problem.
Here, urologists will examine his sample and try to figure out what's causing his pain.
I'm hoping if he's got a stone or something or a bit of calcium or whatever in there, it's come through and... Well, I hope that urine he had in there was better looking than the one at home.
Still not a healthy colour, but it looked more healthy than it is.
Also in Stoke, paramedics Paul and Sean are nearly 8 hours into their shift.
Oh, golly gosh. It's catching up with me now, getting up at 5.
I'm definitely the grumpiest.
Yeah.
Especially in the...
late
at night, I think.
Yeah.
And early in the morning. Mm. And maybe some of the bits in between as well.
Ambulance service, is the patient breathing?
Yes, the patient's breathing, just injured.
And what's the reason for the call? What's happened?
He tried to jump from one of those things that in the park and he actually hit his bike on the ground.
So he's fallen off his bike today. And how old is he?
How old are you, Mackenzie? He's 12 years old.
Is he bleeding?
He is bleeding, yeah.
We are going to 12-year-old little boy who has fallen off his bike and hurt his face. Apparently his front teeth got broken, bless him.
Let's hope he wore a helmet.
Yeah, let's hope so. Most children that age don't want to wear helmets, don't they?
Hopefully his parent is on scene.
Well, I hope so, because it's scary for him if not.
My first thoughts on the way to this job is this could either be really bad or not very much at all. So we didn't get a great deal of information, so it could be that he's got a slight scratch to his face or he's got a really terrible head injury.
Hello, young man. Are you Mackenzie?
12-year-old Mackenzie was playing in a skate park when he fell off his bike. His mum, Sarah, and sister Katie are with him.
Right, my lovely, what did you do?
I was riding on a bike and then I faced one the floor.
You did, didn't you? You did a great job. Open your mouth for me, sweetheart. Oh, you've bashed all your teeth, haven't you, mate? Did anybody see him do this?
Mark? Where that one?
This chappy here, did you see him fall?
Yeah.
Did he hit his head or his neck?
I don't know. I just saw his face.
Your wrist too.
When we first saw Mackenzie, his wounds looked quite severe. He had quite a lot of broken teeth. He also had injured his wrist, so potentially he could have fractured his wrist as well.
So did you feel like you bashed your head or bent your neck at all?
Stuck on a crappy phone, mate.
This is just for the paperwork for the doctor's surgery and stuff, okay. So, Mackenzie, you didn't lose consciousness at all? You didn't go to sleep straight away or anything like that? Did you get straight up and walk afterwards?
I just got up and then I was like, calling ambulance.
Good boy, you've done the right thing.
Have you got any pain here at all? How about here?
The first thing we need to establish in a case like Mackenzie's is that he's got no other injuries which are masked by this distracting injury to his face. So we need to make sure that he's got no spinal injury, no severe head injury.
Can you lift your head upwards, skywards? How's that? Now look to me. Now look to the other way where your sister is.
And down to your chest.
Down to your chest?
Good boy.
OK. Is that all right? There's no discomfort there? I know your teeth, they broke at the top, but can you put them together?
I think what we'll do, my love, is walk you over to the ambulance and then we'll check you properly, OK? All right, do you think you can walk? Yeah? All right, we just take it nice and slowly, all right? That's it, take it easy. Good lad.
Mackenzie, being really calm, made it much easier for us to deal with him, didn't it?
Yeah, he actually calmed his family members down. He sort of kept them calm, really. He was a trooper, he was.
To check for any internal injuries, Mackenzie needs to go to hospital.
Now, your wrist-wise, can you move that much at all?
I can't, like, lift it up. I can lift it down. It's just...
They're hurting, yeah?
Mackenzie requires an X-ray on his wrist, and his broken teeth have to be examined before they become infected.
So I think the main concern is this wrist and his teeth, mate. Are these your adult teeth you've got?
Yeah.
Okay.
And I've got a swollen top lip.
Yes, you have. Yeah. I think your teeth have gone into your lip, to be honest with you.
Were you wearing a helmet, mate?
No.
No, that's okay.
I'm still trying to get my son to wear a helmet because it's not cool to wear a helmet.
Honestly.
No.
My kids, it's drilled into them now.
I think it does bring it home how important wearing a helmet is, definitely, being in our job.
Yeah, it's got to be a massive message, really, hasn't it? Without a doubt. You've only got one brain, aren't you?
How much pain are you in?
Out of 10, 6.
A 6?
Where's that, in your face or
in
your wrist?
In your face more than your wrist?
My wrist, about like a 4.
About a 4.
Just syringe it in. Hopefully, won't swallow too much blood, but it looks all dried around your face, which is one positive thing.
Paul gives Mackenzie liquid paracetamol to help with his pain.
I said to my mum, I'm gonna be rich because of the tooth fairy.
Oh, right. You have
the
money.
Do they take partial bits of
tooth? I can think of easier ways to do it.
So, do you think that the tooth fairy does come for partial teeth?
I suppose.
He deserved a pound, didn't he? But I think he'd swallowed most of his teeth, so I don't know whether there was anything left
for
the tooth fairy to take.
He might have 50p then.
Maybe.
Got some fans out there.
Fast on my teeth.
I hope Mackenzie gets his smile back.
He's going to have some sort of cosmetic surgery, isn't he? Because.
They will do because of his age.
His adult teeth, unfortunately, as well. Yeah. If he'd been a couple of years younger, he might have escaped with baby teeth. Right, we'll do one more of these, then we'll nip you up to show them your teeth at the hospital, OK? See what they want to do about it and get that wrist looked at.
The nearest A&E department is a 5-minute drive away.
I was just trying to jump at home. And then the bars was twisted and then I just went straight to my face.
Oh, bless you.
I could tell I need to go to the hospital because my teeth.
Yeah, it's not great. Have you done anything like this before?
Well, he's a bit of a character stunt-wise, but he doesn't know me hurting. He's only just started going out to play as such.
You've ruined it.
Yeah.
Can happen to anyone that car. Oh, it's just bad luck that he's landed like that. Yeah. Well, you're gonna have some cracking bruises on your face to show your mates when you go back to school, aren't you?
A fun afternoon practicing tricks on his bike has ended with a trip to Royal Stoke University Hospital.
Do you think you can walk, young man?
Yeah.
Yeah? All right, bud, well done.
Here, doctors will x-ray Mackenzie's wrist and clean his wounds, but he'll also have to be examined by an emergency dentist.
I'll have everybody staring at you now, wondering what you've been doing. I don't like teeth. It's not my bag, that.
I wasn't kind of expecting you to go looking for them.
I would say Mackenzie is one of the bravest children that I've been to. Children normally panic in that situation, but Mackenzie was calm throughout, so, yeah, he's a credit to himself, really.
Before training to be a paramedic, I was actually in my basic training in the army to be a combat medical technician. But unfortunately, due to injury, I got discharged.
So are you doing anything after work then?
No, I'm going home. I'm going to have something to eat. And then I'm going to have to stay up a bit tonight because I'm on nights tomorrow. So I'll stay up watching telly.
Nice lying.
Are you doing anything?
No, not really. I always have best intentions to go and exercise, but I never do.
And me. Because I always have the intention to make plans and have a life, but you just get home and you're knackered, aren't you?
Yeah.
Ambulance service, is the patient breathing?
Yes. I can't get my breath at the moment.
OK.
I've had it once before and I've had a heart attack.
You're the patient?
Yes, yeah. I am, Duck.
We've got some help arranged for you, OK?
So we've got a female, age unknown, difficulty in breathing, blocked nose, chest and upper back pain the last 24 hours. Previous heart attack, suspected heart attack now. Mm-hmm. She's taken aspirin.
Good.
It is concerning when we get the job come through and it says that the patient is experiencing difficulty breathing and has a previous heart attack. So it's crucial we get there as soon as possible and we get the correct treatment started pretty much straight away.
To the west of Stoke, paramedic Chris and student paramedic Louise have just arrived at the home of a woman who's having difficulty breathing.
Yeah, Doc.
I'm Louise and this is Chris. Right, so what's the story then?
I had a heart attack 3 months ago.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I was like this before.
Okay.
But I've got a blocked up nose.
Yeah.
I'm trying coffee cup and I'm choking myself.
75-year-old grandmother Patricia rang 999 when she was struggling to catch her breath.
Right, I'll have a little listen to you, just because your oxygen levels are quite low, so we'll pop some oxygen on you.
As the amount of oxygen in Patricia's blood is low, her organs aren't getting enough to function properly.
Listening to the chest can be a really good indicator as to what's going on in the lungs. So, for example, a wheeze would indicate narrowing of the airways. OK, lovely. It's not really a wheeze, it's more like a rubbing sound.
OK.
In Patricia's case, the rubbing sound could indicate some sort of inflammation in the lungs. And this is what happened when you last had your heart attack? Yeah.
Okay.
I'm crying.
Exactly the same. No, it's all right.
Just give you...
Pop some oxygen on you just to bring your levels up.
I've got a lot going on.
You've got a lot going on, what, medically or in your personal life?
What's up with you? What conditions do you have?
Everything.
Oh. That's just a bit of oxygen, sweetheart. All right.
What medical conditions do you suffer from?
I've got breast cancer.
OK. So let's work through it all. So, with your heart, you've had a heart attack.
Yeah.
Right. With your lungs, any COPD?
Yeah, because I've been terrible.
Any asthma?
No.
OK, and when did you last have COVID?
End of March.
How are you feeling with that oxygen now?
Not too bad.
It's feeling a
bit
better.
Mm-hmm. Better than it was. Mm-hmm.
OK.
Am I ready?
I think so. What do you reckon?
I don't know.
You don't know?
I don't know.
Switched it a bit more because it's not gone above 93 nautical.
A normal blood oxygen level is around 99%. Even with the extra being given through her mask, Patricia is struggling to get enough oxygen into her bloodstream.
Well, you've won yourself a trip to the hospital.
Oh, have I?
For a start.
You want me tablets?
Where are your tablets?
They're on the table in the box.
On the table in this table?
Yeah, a little box.
There are.
Now, if you go on, get them first. I won't put you off.
That one.
Now, Luke. Yeah. Now, in the...
bowl.
The bowl, there's some more water tablets for Rosamide.
She was all, get this, get that.
You got me a paracetamol?
Yeah. Well, I haven't got them, they're in the bowl.
And my nasal spray.
Yeah, that's in here.
I felt a bit like a butler, but it was all in good spirits.
Louise tries a different approach by giving Patricia a stronger concentration of oxygen.
Now, I don't know what you're putting here, but that's better.
Is it?
Some good old oxygen.
I'm really a bit better now.
Good.
Marius, what have you done? His birthday today.
Whose birthday?
My husband.
Oh,
the one last 6 years ago.
Oh, sorry about that.
He was 80. He was older than me. He's 86 today. Yeah. So
oh, is it supposed to be his birthday?
I come down.
Yeah.
Patricia and Morris had been married for nearly 50 years.
He's upstairs.
Yeah, OK. Mm-hmm. Have you got his ashes?
Mm.
I think that's the best way, to be fair. Take your time. Just shuffle across and pop your bum on there for me. Oh. OK.
Nasal spray.
Lovely.
And the nasal spray.
And your nasal, sorry. Sorry, boss. Won't happen again.
Right.
There, our curtains are open. Anything else, boss, before we go?
No, only the light.
And the light, right. Anything else?
No.
Right, OK.
If you were going into hospital and you could only take three things, what would you take?
I'd probably take my phone,
mm-hmm.
my dog, if they're allowed. If they're not allowed, then maybe a photo of my dog.
Photo of your dog.
Because I'm obsessed. And some chocolate.
It's a short drive to the nearest A&E, but Patricia and husband Morris were once globetrotters.
We went away a lot.
Yeah.
We went to about 6 or 7 different countries over the years.
Whereabouts have you been?
Oh, we've been to Armin over 3 times.
Mm.
Fantastic. Bulgaria, Tunisia, went on a camel.
Oh, okay.
I couldn't walk after.
I really enjoy chatting to patients on the way to hospital. They're so fascinating. They've got so much to tell.
It's a 15-minute drive to Royal Stoke University Hospital. Here, doctors will want to carry out scans and x-rays to get to the bottom of Patricia's breathlessness.
She was a nice lady, wasn't she?
I know, she was lovely. She liked to crack the whip a bit with you, though.
She did a bit, didn't she? Got a bit bossy. Get this, get that. Don't forget this. Get me tablets, get this.
I like a woman who knows what she wants.
Mackenzie, who fell off his bike in a skate park, had a lucky escape. At hospital, x-rays showed his wrist wasn't broken, just sprained.
I didn't go in a cast, but I had some arm holder which kept me wrist up, so just see if it could get better.
He only sprained his wrist, but he did break 3 of his teeth.
When I first got to the dentist the next day, a part of my right tooth was hanging off. Now they're going to try build it back up just so I can eat again normal. The paramedics, they did a really good job. I was falling asleep, and they were making sure that I don't fall asleep just in case, like, I went unconscious or something. I love to bike nearly every day to school and back, and then after school I can just go out with my friends for a few hours. I'd never start riding bikes until another incident happens, maybe.
Patricia, who was finding it hard to breathe, had scans and blood tests which revealed she wasn't having a heart attack. But a month later, she suffered a cardiac arrest. The swift actions of hospital staff saved her life. She's now back home and recovering well. Mark, who has one kidney, was given antibiotics in hospital for a urinary tract infection. He also had a scan to check for prostate cancer and is waiting for the results. Graham, who had chest pains, stayed in hospital overnight. Tests confirmed that he'd suffered a reaction to the medication he'd taken. And Lindsay, who had liver disease, had her ear stitched in hospital and was given antibiotics for an infection. She was put on the liver transplant list, but sadly passed away before she could have the operation. Next time, a woman collapses unconscious with dangerously low blood sugar levels.
Hello, chicken.
Hello.
When we first arrived and found Glenys on the floor, we knew that she was in a critical condition.
A patient with chest pain proves difficult to treat.
You need to either come and sit up or lie down, OK?
He's got some noisy breathing in their way, potentially some form of an airway obstruction, and that's ultimately not a good thing.
And a young mother has severe stomach cramps.
As soon as I get in the bathroom, I like pass out on the floor.
I immediately noticed how pale she was. This could indicate that her blood pressure was like so low. She was bleeding somewhere, possibly bleeding internally.